So therefore I invite to talk about Geeta Bhardwaj, to talk about criteria for impalement of hospitals. But before that, I'll take 2 minutes in describing what Geeta is. Not Geeta, Bhagavad Geeta. So Bhagavad Geeta basically has 18 chapters. And in the first chapter, Krishna only listens. So therefore, if we listen to the patient, 90% of our insurance queries will be over. In the second chapter, Krishna describes in great detail. So if you discuss in great detail with the TPS as well as with the patients, your disputes will be over. From 3rd to 17th chapter, Krishna gives in great detail all explanations. Darata bhi hai virat sarup dikha ke, so you'll have to explain, aisa karoge to insurance cancel ho jayega. Puchkarta bhi hai, chinta mat karo, main tumhare saath hu. Don't worry, I'm with you. I'm help you out in settling your claim. And if there is a claim rejection, I will talk to the TPA doctor. And in the 10th, he asks the patient to explain what he has understood. He describes everything in great detail. So I hope our Geeta will follow the principles of counseling and describe in great detail the impalement of hospitals. Geeta ji.
Thank you. Hi, everybody. I'm Dr. Geeta Bhardwaj. And I'm going to stick to the 10 minutes rather than 15 minutes. And then maybe we can open the house for questions. Okay, so good. So let's say we are all transplant surgeons. So there you are, okay, all of you. And on one side, you have 5 rich guys, each one needing one organ. So the heart, pancreas, kidneys, the lungs, and of course, the liver. Okay, and you have nobody, no single organ. On the other side, there's this one poor guy who walks into your hospital, who's actually asked just for a crocin, and he's sitting there. So if you were to give one injection to this poor guy, you would actually get 5 healthy organs and 5 people could live. Would you do it? I need to see hands. So anybody who could do it? Okay, so nobody would do it. My question is why?
Only those who want to be hanged can do it.
So let's say there's nobody who's going to get hanged. So why would you not do it? I saw somebody's hand up there. Okay, the question is that there are 5 patients of yours who require those 5 organs. And on the other side, you have another patient who is again a poor guy, but he's healthy. You quietly kill that guy, you get 5 healthy organs. Would you do that? No, why not? Unethical? Why? That's why I'm asking you. Why not? Okay. Logically, it actually makes sense, isn't it?
No.
Okay. The reason why you would not do it and that one answer is unethical is because you are a stakeholder in the decision. And we've been talking about stakeholders. Since morning, we've been saying that we are stakeholders in health insurance, in medicine, and so on and so forth. For everybody's information, I'm basically a cardiothoracic surgeon. So I operate also. I do not ask for money, though. I do it free of cost. And that's in Pune when I had the time. Coming to the next one, we talk about the criteria for empanelment of hospitals. Before that, let's at least define what a hospital means. So as per the WHO, it is the social and a medical organization which actually functions to give you all kinds of treatments, both preventive as well as curative, as well as the outpatient, all right? And that is for the family in its own environment, okay? Now, coming to the IRDA, or the IRDAI, the way they define the hospital is when you are registered as a hospital under one of the acts, which could be either the Clinical Establishments Act or it could be the other acts, though not the Shop and Establishment Act, that's one. And of course, you also need to have about 10 to 15 beds depending on the population of that city, and the nursing staff, the medical staff has to be qualified, and you also have to have some kind of records on a daily basis, all right? So any question on the definition of the hospital?
What do you mean the 10 or 15?
Sir, it is there. So 10 bedded is for the people who have less than 10 lakh population, and 15 beds are for more than that.
There is a severe objection to this clause.
Sir, can we have the discussion at the last?
Yeah, sir? Can I finish up?
We'll note down the,
All right. I'm not going to be asking any questions. So let me finish off. And then maybe you can come back. Yes.
We'll note down the answers and then we'll discuss it the last.
Regulator. So let's go back. All right, sir.
We'll have the discussion at the la.
Doctor, sir, I'm sorry I made a mistake by asking you a question. Okay. So let's go to the next one. We talk about the hospital categorization, and that is where we are talking about the criteria for empanelment. At present, there is no real standard where we are talking about a pan-India categorization of hospitals. So the first one is how we actually look as medicos to a hospital. So we talk about the system type, where it could be an allopathic hospital or an Ayush hospital. So you have Ayurvedic hospitals and the homeopathic clinics and so on and so forth. The other one is ownership based. So they could be government, they could be public, they could be private owned, or they could be trust and aid or NGOs or so on and so forth. The third one is the size-wise. So you have a corporate hospital, and then you have nursing homes, and then you have clinics and dispensaries. Function-wise, are we talking about primary, secondary, or tertiary care? And the last one, of course, is the specialty hospital. So are we talking about multiple specialties which are available? So you call yourself a multi-specialty hospital. Or are we talking about single specialties? Or a lot of hospitals, unfortunately, though they do not have too many super specializations, they still call themselves a super specialty hospital. So basically what we're talking about is a non-standardization of categories in the hospital. Now coming to the next one, and we talk about it from the patient's perspective. So what is he looking at? One is he's looking at the quality, which is like a 50-50. The patients are really not aware of the quality because, frankly, as medicos, we are not very transparent about our own quality. That's one. Secondly, the cost of treatment. I think this is one weightage that a patient always gives. Can I afford this hospital? Can I go to Dr. Trehan and afford it? Can I go to Dr. Devi Shetty and afford it? And can I go to Dr. Agarwal and afford it? So that's how I look at it. The third one is the outcome. The outcome is, again, not really measured by the patient. It's just a word of mouth. So if my friend tells me this doctor is good because he did something good to me, I'm more of a, there's more probability that I'll go to the same hospital or the same doctor. The fourth one, of course, are the interdepartmental coordination. So if I look at the government hospitals, the interdepartmental coordination is not as much as if I look at a corporate hospital. So when I'm talking about an interdepartmental, it's your wards versus your investigations versus your pathology versus your inventories, so on and so forth, as well as the TPA desks or the insurers. All right. And lastly, of course, is the availability of expertise. So do you have a cardiologist? Do you have a cath lab? Do you have an oncologist if I need it for any kind of surgeries? Coming to the regulatory framework, when I talk about the regulatory framework, it has got nothing to do with just the IMA or the MCI framework that we're talking about. This is just about everything and anything which is a regulatory framework. So we talk about the registration of a hospital, and not a lot of states have the Clinical Establishments Act, which is there. All right. Second is wherever you have transplants, you have the HOTA, you have PNDT, you have the BMW certification, the fire safety, your licenses for blood bank. EMR, again, was supposed to be there. It's not there. Electronic medical records. It's not there as of now. Okay, that was supposed to be one of the initiatives that was to be taken up. However, except for some of the corporate hospitals, most of them really do not function on that. The other one is ICD and PCS. You won't believe the kind of claims that we get. We have a diagnosis called ghabrahat. And that leads to a CABG. And the claim is 4.5 lakhs. How am I supposed to use this when you talk about creating new policies or getting us new benchmarks? How do you expect us to use that information to design a policy? It doesn't make sense. It's not really standardized in India. And when I talk about ICD and PCS, there are 90,000 codes. We do not require 90,000 codes in India. Let's standardize it. And that's one thing that I would request the IMA to do. Instead of using 90,000 codes in the ICD-10-CM, it's easier to actually talk about 2,000 codes which we use every day. Is that not easy for anybody to get trained on and use it on a daily basis? It actually helps us more with the transparency, with the analysis, and of course saying that whether this was right, wrong, or whatever. All right. Now coming to the Rohini registration, the IRDA expects every hospital to go through the Rohini registration, and I would request the IMA to take over that as well, because that's again becoming a central repository of hospitals, which is going to help us not only as an insurer, but also as an industry of the healthcare, to know how many hospitals are actually working, and if there are any. Like, for example, there are just about 2 or 3% of the doctors who are really doing something wrong. Why should 98% of the industry be held responsible for the 2%? So can we not have something like the banking? Banking industry has something like that. They have a central repository of hospitals. They have a central repository of hospital of patients, accounts. So is it possible that we can also have the same thing? And that is the whole endeavor of the Rohini by the IRDA. So the next one is, of course, the PPN. I'm not touching upon the PPN rates, absolutely. Cashless utilization. One thing which is very sad is, if you're already empaneled with me, it's very difficult to know that there is about 70 to 80% of your cases coming from the hospitals as reimbursement. And I do not know why that is. It could be one of the reasons that you have two different billings. So it could be a reimbursement versus cashless, and cashless is not too much, so you want to just go in for the reimbursement and so on and so forth. The other one is discount. That is something I think as a resolution we need to figure out what we're going to be doing about the discounts. And if it is so wrong, like you all said that it was wrong, and believe me, I'm a part of your fraternity. If it is so, then why are the hospitals even giving it? Why are they not getting up and saying that this is wrong and we will not do it? So if there's even one doctor who's doing it, the others are just following suit. And that's not right. So you either decide that that's illegal and we will not do it, or then, you know, then let everybody do it. So we need to figure out what we are doing and where we are, basically, all right? The NABH entry level, that is something which has become a mandate by the IRDAI. Now, the biggest challenge is, I'm an NABH assessor myself. I'm an external assessor for NABH. But I know how much time and effort it takes for a hospital to come to a level of an NABH entry as well. So do we have that much of manpower, that much of training, and that much of motivation by the hospitals and by the IMA to have every hospital under the sun in India as an NABH entry level, all right? So coming to the hospital empanelment in India, we right now, if you look at the health industry of insurance, you look more and more about the utilization. How many cases actually go into a hospital for the policies that are underwritten by the insurer? And that is one of the reasons why it's called a preferred provider network. It's preferred by the patient. There are, if I tell you the numbers, you'll be surprised to know that about 60% of all the patients actually go to the top 300 to 400 hospitals in India. That's it. So who is preferring them? We are not preferring them. It is the patients who are preferring them. Okay, so that's one of the reasons why it was called a preferred provider network. It was all to do with utilization. But like I said, there is no standard of empanelment. The criteria are not standardized. The operational definitions are not standardized across the country. And when we talk about, sir was talking about the outcomes. One of the reasons why the outcomes of a hospital or a treating doctor are not taken into consideration in insurance, and that goes back to quality of the outcome. So you had that question. The reason is because the policies which are underwritten today are indemnity policies. What it basically means is that if there's an event which happens, irrespective of whether the patient died or did not die, I'm going to still pay you the money. So that's called an indemnity policy versus an outcome-based policy, which happens in the US. All right? So they actually measure what is the outcome. If there are 100 patients who come in and 30 of them die, they do not pay you for the 30 of them because your mortality rates are really high. So you're not benchmarking your mortality rates, your morbidity rates, or even your readmission or error rates for that matter. All right? The only reason being because insurance, for insurance, that does not become a forte of their expertise. All right? That I think the expertise should be with you, with the IMA. Coming to some of the cases that I will talk to you about, one of them is the Maharashtra scheme that we have. And there we have close to about 500 hospitals which are there. The eligibility criteria there, of course, is that you have to have 50-bedded hospitals and with 5 ICU beds. The reason being that the whole Maharashtra scheme is meant only for critical ailments. It does not cater to PUOs and UTIs and stuff like that. So these are more of just critical ailments. So the eligibility is 50 beds and above. Now, if you look at this, they are the whole of their, okay, this thing dirty. The NABH, how do you go back? Very funny thing. Your arrow is not working. No, no, I want to open the Excel sheet, man. The NABH criteria. So if you look at this, and you can actually have a look at the criteria here. For the Maharashtra government, what they did was that they did not take all the levels of the NABH. They have taken only few criteria from the NABH. So let's say they have diluted that NABH to all these. So you have, look at the categories here. And the parameters which are given here. I can actually send this to you because this is a public information. So these are the weightages which are given, and each one of this has a different way of what is the transparency, what is the quality, what is the monitoring kind of a thing, what is the safety of the hospital. All of that is coming in. However, if you look at the NABH, you have to have all of these which have to be met. In Maharashtra, however, they have made some of them mandatory and some of them non-mandatory. So you have to have a score of 50% to actually get eligible. And that, I think, is a good starting point for all the hospitals. Okay. Of course, we train them a lot on this, on the NABH criteria. And I think IRDA should also be looking at some of these criteria which can be pushed into the NABH entry level. If I look at the GIPSA, the GIPSA has got more than anything else. If I'm looking at, you know, the benchmark for the criteria, they're almost the same, except that you're not really looking at the medical, the number of hospitalizations, or in Maharashtra, you're not looking at the number of hospitalizations. In GIPSA PPN, you're basically looking at the utilization, the historical data as to how many cases were utilized by this hospital when the PPN was not there. So that is the only difference. One more difference is that in Maharashtra, you're actually looking at the outcome. In the GIPSA PPN, we do not look at the outcome. Coming to the global things that are happening, and we do not really have that in India, one is the safety of the staff. I'm sure the hospitals actually have the safety of the staff. They have their vaccinations and their sterilizers and their hand washes, all of that as per the WHO. However, when we empanel, we are really not looking at the safety of the staff. The second one is the innovation to greener hospitals. So how do we make the hospital more green, as in how do we decrease the the garbage which goes out, and how do you use solar energy, the wind energy, blah, 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 all of that comes in. Innovating or creating a strategy which actually caters to the newer needs of the patient. Wellness. How many of our hospitals are actually put in to our insurance groups because they give more and more of prevention or promotive care? We really do not give that kind of weightage there. And of course, transparency to patient care, patient satisfaction score. There's one exercise that I would like you to do. Please go back, and if you can look at Hospital Compare, that's a beautiful website which actually gives you the comparison of hospitals on a lot of criteria. Okay, it is public. So you put in the names of the hospitals, it tells you how good they are, and you as a patient can actually choose which hospital you would like to go to. It also takes care of the cost in comparison to the other hospitals which are in the same geography. Okay, so but that's not for India, it's for the US, that's for the Medicare and the Medicaid. The challenges in India, I think I already spoke about it. Standardization of criteria, even though we have criteria which are there, the operational definitions are either not defined completely, or then a lot of people are not aware of the operational definitions, and that includes every stakeholder who's there. The second part is the criteria which has to be catered to all levels of the hospital. We're not only talking about corporate hospitals. You're talking about nursing homes, you're talking about those 5-bedded and 10-bedded hospitals as well. Just not criteria which are NABH only for the corporate hospitals. The transparency in designing the criteria, I think that is, this forum would be a good forum to actually sit down and decide what are the criteria that you would like to add or change or delete from what we have at present. It's going to be a work in progress. It will never be a foolproof kind of a design. And of course, hospitals, how do they get NABH accredited at that level? Because we have so many hospitals and very few assessors. And of course, there's a lot of cost which gets involved as well. Thank you.
No, I have certain resolutions to be put forth as very rightly suggested. First and foremost, the empanelment procedure, kindly don't take it in the bad sense, has to be very transparent and corruption-free. I think everybody can agree to have this resolution.
Yes.
Why I am saying this? There are n number of examples, n number of complaints we receive, where now agents have sprung up of various insurance companies who are approaching hospitals and saying that you pay us this much money, we will see that your empanelment is done. This is a very serious issue, which I would humbly request that all the TPA insurance companies should take up. And this is not only happening about your regular insurance empanelment, more so it is happening with Rajiv Gandhi. So I think we passed this resolution that it should be very transparent.
Just transparent.
Yes, okay.
Very transparent.
Another resolution I would like to put and request is whatever Hospital Board of India members hospitals are there, they should be given preference in your empanelment.
Yes.
I would like an...
Why?
Because we are doing a certain set of standards. IMA has devised IMA clinics.
I would here say, let HBI come out with a certification.
Yes.
Let them define their standards. Yes. That standard should be on your HBI site. Yes. Then you start empaneling hospitals with HBI certification. Once that certification is ready, we approach them.
Yes.
To kindly recognize our certification.
Agreed?
No, they will agree only once we are ready. No.
Yeah.
They will agree only once we are ready.
Yes.
So
okay.
let's be ready. So let's apply.
Yeah.
At that time, once it is applied, they will consider it. So it's a good idea.
Yeah.
Let HBI come out with a certification. Let HBI come out with their own standards. And then once they are ready, once suppose you have now 500 hospitals who are empaneled, then we can talk to them and negotiate with them. Why not recognize us?
Sir, to add on to this, can we have a group involving all the stakeholders to develop the standards?
Yeah, that so will that come in our next session of synergy. Yes. IRDA should be strongly, I know and I am very well aware that the criteria for 10 beds / 15 beds is devised by IRDA. But many daycare centers have only 3 beds, 4 beds, 5 beds, ENT, ophthalmology, and now daycare procedures are supposed to be on the rise because it ultimately decreases cost.
The hospital definition, if you look at the IRDA guidelines, that is only for inpatient hospitals.
Not for
when it is
not
single specialty, it's not there.
But
so if it's a high hospital, alright, even if you have just 2 beds, you're still a man. You're still a hospital. Alright? However, if you're a nursing home with 5 beds,
yes,
I was
coming to that. Say I am a suppose there is an anorectal surgeon who does a daycare center in his own nursing home of 5 beds. So automatically he becomes out of your empanelment.
There are daycare procedures
which
can, the patient can go to any of the daycare centers.
This issue is not as simple as it that to just
Ravi, classify. I will pass a resolution that IMA will write to IRDA.
Yes.
That on the following, we will come out with some standard procedure to consider 5-bedded impanelment on the following criteria. Let it be sent to them.
Okay.
It can't be decided here, but we can. It can't be decided here. But IMA will justify why 5-bedded.
Yes.
Earlier it used to be 5-bedded. So we would like to get answers why that 5-bedded was withdrawn, and that we can negotiate with that. But that can be a IMA resolution.
Yes, yes.
Fine.
We also should today resolve through IMA through HBI will help in designing the ICD codes as per
PCS as well.
Yeah, everything, both the codes will promote Rohini, because that is also it's a very simple procedure. Our own members are not aware. It can be done within 5 minutes. And will definitely help in defining objective criteria for an empanelment. And also grading of the various hospitals, which HBI can help. And for information of you all, IMA, HBI has already tied up with NABH to promote entry level NABH accreditation, and we are doing it on a very large scale now. So considering whatever resource constraints you have mentioned, but I think with very minimal cost we are doing it. Thank you.
If IMA proposes to work on ICD and PCS codes along with other stakeholders, will the insurance company consider funding some part of it? Can it be? No, it has to be, because if we are putting court means we are a national body, we are not a Delhi body. If I call similar meetings, suppose I do 4 meetings of such type, it will cost money, because we are doing it for the insurance company, and insurance companies will also be involved. Consider it, pass it on to your seniors and see if it can be considered with that. And otherwise, if we create of our own, there will always be a conflict.
Standardized ICD code and think by the government. We are also answerable to the government.
Agreed.
And we also have to suggest to the government that this is a standardized ICD code. So what?
If we agree to work together.
Yeah.
If we agree.
Selective.
We come out
it
with.
It has to be a selective.
We will come out with the word preferred ICD codes.
You can use the word preferred. That would be not a issue.
But I'm only trying to say, like commonly used ICD codes, we can select where we can involve all the specialty organizations.
No, how would this work group be different from what is the existing ICD code, sir?
If you are doing
this
it,
is
it's
what
fine.
I was.
If you are doing it, it's fine.
No.
What happens is, when IMA is not involved in any project, we are the one who come back into a fight. Why we were not involved? Why we were not a part of it? So what I am trying to say is, it's a medical fraternity. We also have a IMA FOMA, Federation of Medical Associations. All associations and IMA work together. So IMA, FOXI, Gyne, Surgery, Ortho, we all, with all TPAs, with private sector, we can call, we can go and talk to the DGHS, he can appoint somebody from the government, and we can come out with a, it's acceptable to everybody. We have a group of 37,000 IMA leaders to whom we can communicate, take suggestions. So then this can become a foolproof system.
Yeah. That is what I was coming to. It has to be a foolproof system.
No, I have no problem. I said I'm only initiating. IMA is offering its platform to do that.
Okay.
And if it is, of course, the as per actuals, arrangements for travel and other things have to be made by either the TPA or the insurance company or the Ministry of Health, whosoever they make. But it is possible to IMA to, it is possible for IMA to provide services to do that.
Caseless with the, madam, you told me, the caseless with the same rate of reimbursement, once the caseless is approved, then gradually by one or other causes, they reduce and cut off the amount. This is really very serious. And second thing, the TPA from doctor to doctor varies and try to reduce the rate. This is complaint from our South Gujarat zone of ophthalmology. So don't never approach for the caseless. Once they were fixed up with a cataract 24,000, one party approached for 21, one for 19, so they never go and approach for the caseless.
Sir, rather like this, madam, we need a uniformity of pricing. We need a uniformity of package rates.
That's what I'm coming to. How many resolutions do you make, sir?
minimum 50 by the end of the day. No, let's try to understand. Our aim is to have 50 resolutions by the end of the day.
Your the numbers that you're talking about, the 24 is the maximum that is to be payable. After that, it depends on the grading which has been given. For whatever reason, there could be a reduction. Now, if you're talking about the pricing, which has to be the same, it also depends on the audit that is done in the hospital. If they find that the grading has to be lower, the amount of money which is given as a procedure is also lower.
Yeah.
Sir, can I put forward this, sir? Package rates. Package rates are different with different companies, different TPAs. It is there. So we need a uniformity. For that, we need a uniform grading of the hospitals. So these two things must be uniform throughout the country, grading and package rates. So according to the grading, we can have the package.
Sir, who will do the grading of the hospital, sir?
So that's what we want. We want to have, we will have a forum. We will,
sir, which body is entitled to do that, and who would do that?
We'll form a body and then we will we will.
Sir, whether that will be acceptable to all the stakeholders or to the providers?
That's why.
It's only a proposal.
It's a proposal so that we can have a common body among ourselves. We are the stakeholders. We will form the body. We will grade the hospital.
Sir, first thing is, I believe, sir, that we should be now seeing the perspective from the provider side also, sir. Sir, whether the provider agrees to an IMA coding of their hospital as A, B, C, D, and or whether, I mean, how do we enter into this kind of a grading without taking the providers into consideration?
I would like to come back to what our president said.
Yes, sir.
Let us do it. Let us do it.
Yeah,
it is premature. It is too premature to discuss. But I have now a couple of points. I'll just take 2 minutes. First point they said, one other point Madam raised was, why hospital give discounts? Okay, let's try to understand what is a hospital and what is a doctor. A doctor is a professional. Doctor is supposed to have a degree. He is supposed to be registered. He is supposed to have some privileges. And is accountable under the code of conduct. To open a hospital, I need not be a professional. I can be a businessman. I can be a 10th pass. I can hire agents. I can hire marketing agents. I can advertise. I can market. I can give commissions. I can give cuts. That's the discrepancy with that. So therefore, hospitals give discounts. They can. But they cannot give discount on my part. Doctors cannot give discounts. Under the MCI Act 6.4.1 and 6.4.2, doctors are not allowed to give discounts with that. Now, today what is happening is when hospitals are giving discounts, they are forcing doctors also to give discounts. Yes. And those doctors who refuse, they come out of the non-preferred consultants of the hospital. This happens. That's one. Two, one of the points raised was I could not understand that safety is not looked after by the TPAs, by the impanelment. I think it's a serious concern. It's a serious concern. Because now the message which is going to IMA is that preferred hospitals may not be safe because they are giving you a cheaper panels. So therefore, we may come back and pass a resolution at IMA level that preferred hospitals does not mean that they are safe. They only mean that they are satisfying the cheaper, they are giving alternatives as cheaper. Now, cheaper means what?
No.
No,
sir.
I said.
That is not the way to be put up for a preferred provider network.
I said.
Is not what it is all about, sir. It is
not
about.
Let me finish. Now, please go back and analyze the cardiac surgery packages. All your preferred hospitals, when they do mitral valve replacement, they are also doing tricuspid valve repair. If you see 10 cases of mitral valve surgery today, you will find 9 of them have a tricuspid valve repair. Tricuspid valve repair is done to cover the cost of the concession they are giving in mitral valve surgery. It's added on whether it is required or not. Every patient of GI surgery, omentum is removed to cover up the cost of concession being given. So let's not take concession as the only criteria. For me, the criteria is concession only after the safety and the quality is maintained. There I have a disturbance. There I have an objection from IMA. Because I'm seeing billing every day. I visit so many hospitals. I'm a part of 1100 decision making in Delhi Medical Council. I've seen the billing. And I've seen how all the hospitals who are giving discounts are covering the cost by adding other things so that their bill is not, that concession cost is covered completely. So safety is my concern, quality is my concern. And if the message is going is that empanelment does not involve safety, I think it's a matter of concern to me.
So I would disagree with you with that. What I'm saying is that we are not giving a weightage to the quality in empanelment, which we should be. Please understand that. That is not what I said. What I said was that it's not that you, if you look at a hospital, why would I go to a Leelavati rather than a small little hospital? The reason is that there are so many patients going there and I know that their quality is going to be good. Unfortunately, in India, most of our public hospitals have much better results. But we do not go there. That is because of the hygiene factors. There are other hygiene factors which are there. The waiting periods, blah, 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 all of that is there. However, when I'm talking about quality, I'm just saying that that is not a measurable criterion at present. And as a professional, I would want that to be a criterion which comes in into the empanelment. Where in mass insurance policies, if we have that as a criterion, then I fail to understand that in Mediclaim, why we don't not have it. One of the reasons being that the hospitals came back to us saying that we do not measure it at present.
Yes. So I think if the hospitals are made to measure it, sir.
I think both of us are saying the same thing. Both of us are saying the same thing. I am only trying to say is that quality and safety has to be the first criteria, not the finances.
Sir,
because concession will always come when quality and safety is not there.
No, sir. That I will disagree to that, sir, to an extent that when the insurance company goes to an hospital for a provider network and does a package, what you are saying that, you know, in the packages, they are compromising the cost of the doctors and compromising, you know, so many things. It's not like that. The package takes care of a lot of things there, and a package also does not compromise the doctor cost to an extent that a doctor has to leave the hospital because he is giving a discounted rate from the hospital. The question is how these doctors who are there in the preferred provider network hospitals still manage to do an operation with a cost of 5 lakh as the doctor cost, manage to do an operation with an 18 lakh of cost, manage to do an operation with a 27 lakh of their cost as a doctor cost in that preferred provider network hospital. Same procedure. It can happen in 2 lakh, which they do it in 20 lakhs, which they do it in 25 lakhs and 28 lakhs also. So what is the criteria of a doctor also has to be looked into in totality. We cannot just leave the doctors out, look at only the preferred provider, look at only the patient and look at only the discounting pattern.
You have misunderstood the questions. I am saying is, under the Medical Council of India ethics regulations, 6.4.1, doctors' fees discounts cannot be given. Rebates cannot be given. The heading is rebates and commissions. Yes.
Yes, sir, please.
I have a question on that, sir. I only end often the forum.
Sir, can you introduce yourself, sir?
Yes, sir. I represent Religare Health Insurance. Sir, coming on to the same question, you know, I won't name the hospital in the forum, but there's a hospital in Mumbai where two of our claims came for the angioplasty. Same doctor did the procedure. In the both cases, it was a single stent that was put in, but the surgeon fees for the same doctor changed just because there was a difference in the sum insured. When we questioned the doctor, he had only one answer which he had given, that he is my patient. I have the liberty to charge 2 lakhs, I have the liberty to charge 6 lakhs, and I have the liberty to do it free of cost also.
So I'm only saying
no, so my question is,
no,
this is doctor himself who is indulging into discounting.
I am only trying to say is, we are not talking here about the unethical practices done by a segment of the society. We are not discussing. We are here taking into consideration that we are not talking about unethical acts. We are basically talking about MCI criteria 6.4.1, rebates and commissions. We are not supposed to do free patients. We are not supposed to give discounts. We are not supposed to waive off our fees, which is happening every day. If I do a camp today, that WHO day 50% discount, that's not allowed. Legally, ethically, that's not allowed. Because if I write down 50% discount, So for my neighbor's patients will come back to me. If suppose both of us are practicing together, I give a discount, his patients will come back to me. So that means I am diverting his patients. Ethically, it's not allowed. So I'm only talking about the ethical part of it. I'm only talking about the ethical part of it, that hospitals can give discounts, they have fine, but they cannot ask hospitals, doctors to give discounts, one. And two, we need to come back and rethink and talk to the insurance companies that the rates should take into consideration safety and quality. Even if the package rate increased by 10% or 20%, safety and quality should be considered. I was not aware that safety and quality is not a part of consideration. So that should be suggested from IMA as a part of discussion.
So safety, last 2 minutes for this session.
Can I just, considering we also have to move forward, we definitely can be resolved that we appeal, IMA appeals that patient, doctor safety and quality outcomes, which he mentioned, the outcomes should be also be considered while deciding upon the packages and the empanelment.
Sir, NABH entry level involves all those things.
Yeah, it does.
Yes. One very important thing, when we are discussing about the discounts and everything from the hospital, whenever hospital is giving discount on any bill, they are not giving discount on their own bill, they are simply discounting the doctor's bill. They are just reducing the doctor's bill maybe by 50%, by maybe 100%. It is never the hospital bill which is being given a discount. A discount is always given on doctor's fee.
And I just have to, last line, Geeta ji, this is a very common phenomena that if the insurance bill is, suppose the bill is 50,000 and the hospital gets 45,000, they will give 5,000 discount. This is illegal in the US. They will not charge the patient. So the patient gets admitted that you will not be charged any extra amount if there is any deduction. What will happen in that case is hospital will always overbill to take care of the deductions.
The idea today is to create a platform for dialogue. We cannot solve all the issues in one day. So I think there are certain sensitive issues, because how we look at it is different from how the insurance looks at it.
Let us
have a dialogue forum. That's the idea, is to have. So if there are sensitive issues, we will address them in the course of the proceedings, not on the first day.
If you can just allow me to make a quick point on this. Can I?
Sir, I just want to put one fact that definition of hospital, it has to be universal. And that starts from a land criteria or urban development or Nagar Nigams or all statutory bodies' definitions as well. And because with the enactment of Clinical Establishment Act, the hospital requirement, land area requirement and construction requirement are need to be considered, because every stakeholder is defining hospital definition by their own. So there needs to be a universal definition of a hospital, starting from land requirement, construction, empanelment, and all. Because right now, every stakeholder is defining their own, you can say that definition.
I just wanted to make a quick note, sir.
You know, basically, right now, I think the insurance people should be thinking of becoming doctor-centric as compared to the hospital-centric policies. Why I'm saying is, the same doctor, what probably we are discussing, the same doctor would charge, let's say, or the patient would be charged 6 lakhs with a certain doctor fees in a corporate hospital, without naming it. And in another hospital, the same procedure or the same treatment cost would come down to 50%. So, and today's world, let me tell you, a single specialty or multi or couple of specialty or super specialty hospitals, which are let's say 20 bed, 50 bed, 30 bed, can provide better quality treatment to a patient than a corporate hospital. Whereas the corporate hospital, the bill to the insured and to the insurer both is maybe 4 times higher. So can it be, or can we move towards a doctor-centric insurance rather than a hospital centric insurance.
I had put this idea forward to all the people in a lot of forums at present, because I speak on a lot of forums. So one of the pilots that I had for the Middle East was that I started speaking about the expat insurance guys. We do a lot of medical insurance, tourism as well. And they come in for big ticket items. They do not come in for small ticket items. So we're talking about something like a liver transplant or a lung transplant and stuff like that. So they come all the way from the Middle East because India is supposed to be the hubs for medical tourism. My question today is that we could start empaneling doctors rather than empaneling hospitals. Now, the reason being that today, let's say I talk about Dr. A, who's maybe my mentor, and my mentor has been Dr. Grant from Pune. He's no more longer there. However, till today, he has been number one. But tomorrow, after, let's say, 10 years or 5 years down the line, I become number one because he's no longer there. All right? So if I start empaneling doctors and telling them that these are the 10 things that you do in your daily basis. So as a cardiothoracic surgeon, I do a CABG and a transplant and blah, blah, blah. So these are the 10 things that I do. I will, as an insurer or as a TPA, I will tie up with you as a doctor for X amount of money rather than empaneling hospitals. So, and I don't care where you take the patient. You take him to Leelavati, you take him to Breach Candy, you take him to your own hospital, as long as your outcome is the same. All right? Now, the fact remains that there's a win-win situation in it, because what I'm doing here is I'm changing the dynamics, the power dynamics, from the hospital to the doctor. What is surprising, however, is no matter how many forums I've been there to, and I wanted to run a pilot on this, none of the doctors are ready for it. And now my question to the doctors is why?
What I'll do is, I'll take it forward from here. IMA will support you. IMA will support you. Let us come out, let's take it forward. It's a good idea, it's not a bad idea. And we can do a pilot study on this particular subject.
Please understand, now, it's not going to be only IMA, sir. It has to be the IRDA and the insurance.
We will talk to them. We can have a meeting with them. Just one more minute. Just. Now, somehow or the other, the message is going on is that we are confronting each other. No, we are not. We are not confronting each other. Idea is to come forward with consensus. We are bound to differ. To differ is our right. To bound is differ. So if anybody is differing, that's our right. We only want to come out with some common consensus. Suppose you feel somewhere we are doing wrong. Pass a resolution from your side that you people are doing this wrong, that we will take it up. Where we feel that insurance company is wrong, we are communicating to you to pass it on to your people. So the idea that this platform is absolutely open. Let's not confront each other. Let's come out, try to come out with a consensus. If there is a confrontation, it only means perception in the society is different. Because whatever I'm saying is my perception. So if it is my perception as a president of IMA, it may be the perception of the medical society. So therefore, we need to come out with some very definitive resolutions or statements in harmony, so that it is in the interest of the society.